Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We are welcome to a very special ceremony marking the retirement of Senior Master Sergeant Kenneth Holcomb after 27 years of honorable service to the United States Air Force and our nation. Lieutenant Colonel Paul D. Villagrand, Director of Air Force Special Operations Command, Public Affairs, will officiate today's ceremony. I'm Airman First Class Brandy Durr, your Master of Ceremony for this landmark event. We are pleased to have some special guests with us today. Sergeant Holcomb's wife, Jennifer, their children, sons Josh and Anthony, and their daughter Rory. She's also joined by his mother, Sharon Holcomb, father Barry Holcomb, sister Michelle Holcomb, and in-laws Herb and Sue Bruce. We also welcome AFSOC, Wing, and Force Support Squadron guests. Again, thank you and welcome. Ladies and gentlemen, please rise for the arrival of the official party, hoisting of the colors, and the singing of our national anthem, sung by Sergeant Holcomb's daughter, Rory.
He cross-trained over to visual information and then went from there to Europe, right? The first time in Europe, the Ramstein, where he actually worked for the commander-in-chief for USAID, right? in his presentation center.
Yes, sir.
Good. After that assignment, he went to Florida, right?
Yes, sir.
Came back to Rover Field, first assignment for 6 years where I forgot to mention, while you were saying you got promoted below the zone, right?
Yes, sir.
So he's already been doing some great things and been recognized for some significant achievements to get below the zone, which is a big deal in the United States Air Force on the enlisted side. Very small percentage of people get promoted below the zone because, as you all know, in the Air Force, we test for promotions, and the below the zone promotion is a promotion for achievement. Essentially, the commanders are given a certain amount of promotions to be able to hand out, and it's a rare deal. You meet someone who's promoted below the zone, because it's really that they've stood out amongst their peers for something they've done. So, Probert Field after Europe. I noticed actually a trend in his career. He went from basically, correct me if I'm wrong, you went Florida, Europe, D.C., Florida, Europe, D.C., with a little Korea thrown in there, right?
Sure.
It was kind of those round robin. He spent most of his career either Florida, Washington, D.C., or Europe. So came to here, Herbert, met your wife, got married, had your first son while you were here, your first assignment. While you were here, he was at Blue Flag, which is an exercise that's conducted by our combat command. He supported that in a visual information capacity. And then from here, he went to DINFOS, right?
To DINFOS?
Yes, sir.
And his assignment at DINFOS, he was assigned to move trailers, of all things. That sounds kind of crazy, but back then, mid-90s, we were moving, the public affairs curriculum, or the BI and public affairs, was moving from Fort Bend, Benjamin Harrison, to Fort Meade in Maryland. And he was assigned to move trailers, at least initially, before he got into his academic teaching portion of it. And I think there you made tech.
Yes, sir.
You made tech there. From DINFOS, he went back to
Naples,
Italy, to work for NATO. He showed me some of his achievements there, but the one that stuck out in my mind for him in Italy was that he really, really, really wanted to deploy. And this was back in the day and age where we didn't deploy quite as much as we do now. And Sarajevo was an opportunity for him to deploy. Unfortunately, there was no visual information slots for him to deploy from there. So he volunteered to deploy as a FM, right, to manage money. That's pretty amazing, really. Take a career field that you're not really doing, willing to do it in a deployed location, and take that challenge on. And I'm not sure I've met anybody who's willing to do that. And that was actually pretty impressive. Although he did say he spent his whole time working with French lieutenant colonels while you were there. So you had the good and the bad, I guess. and I'm trying to remember, was your daughter born when you were that?
Yes, that'll be our next
assignment. Patrick was the next one. And in Patrick, he worked for a organization that monitored other countries for nuclear assurity, essentially, correct? And I thought, well, I don't know what that is, but we haven't been attacked by any of our enemies in a nuclear capacity, so he must have done a good job while he was there. from there he went
Dr. Ramstein.
Back to Ramstein. Second time back in Germany. And while he's in Ramstein, he was tasked with the perhaps an enviable job of migrating our web capability to the Air Force portal, which, at this point in time, web pages have proliferated. So there's tens of thousands of web pages out there. And his job was to do that for USAFE. So you can imagine the time consumption that took. But on a positive end, he was able to get it done, and that's where we are today. We're still using the Air Force portal. So it was obviously a significant task that was done well and something we're using currently. From there, he came back to APHIS, to work in D.C. again for his last tour in D.C., right? That was your last tour in D.C. While he was there, he worked on DefenseLink, which is the Department of Defense's webpage, which we still use today. So you can see how his career has progressed from local, base, MAGCOM, NATO, and then all the way working to support Department of Defense initiatives. So it's been quite an impressive career. I remember what he told me was something significant from that assignment was he was at APHIS, And something happened that we Air Force decided to stand up something called the Air Force Public Affairs Agency. And they went to, then I think Matt started Holcomb, or had just recently been notified he was gonna be a senior, and said, hey, would you be interested in going to the Air Force Public Affairs Agency? Now, if I was him, I would have said two things. One is, what is the Air Force Public Affairs Agency? Because it was brand new and no one knew what it did then, and maybe still don't, that's my editorial comment. And so he thought he had an option. Come to find out, he was pretty much going to the Air Force Public Affairs Agency, right? But he got to go there. He got to be in charge of what we call sessioning, meaning taking imagery, pictures, videography from across the entire United States Air Force and sessioning it into a database that we use where we can archive stuff. So he was the Air Force's person for getting all imagery and putting it in a database that we can, that public affairs professionals can access. So it was pretty significant. From there, it was somewhat of a small life-changing assignment, right? And he got notified that he had an assignment to Korea, and he was already past his 20-year retirement point, so then it was a decision. And I'm sure it was a tough one for you as well. Does he retire, or does he take the assignment to Korea, knowing full well he's gonna leave his family behind for a year? And they made the sacrifice and sent him on his way to do that 1 year in Korea, which he has said to me on several occasions, while it was difficult being away from his family, it was a very valuable opportunity and learning experience for him to work with a lot of our allies from South Korea while he was there as the superintendent or senior enlisted member of the U.S. Forces Korea Public Affairs Office. From there, oh, and he and I have a lot in common in that we're both runners, and I have very envious of one thing that he achieved while he was there. He ran the Great Wall of China Marathon. Which, you know, that's just incredible. I would like to go see the Great Wall of China. I mean, running the marathon there should be a bonus for me. I'm sure everyone else who doesn't run marathons thinks that I just go watch it and that'll be enough. But that's a pretty good deal. Very, very impressive. And I know you ran a Seoul marathon while you were there. Some other. From there, back to Hurlburt Field for his final assignment as the superintendent for the First Special Operations Wing. So you can see it's been an amazing career. He sent me a lot of information that he had done in his career. One thing he didn't put in there was, and I've only known him for a year now, but he takes care of his people. Amazing, amazing person, takes care of his people. Last year, the First Special Operations Wing Public Affairs Office put in a lot of their people for the end of year awards for public affairs. This is Air Force level. And one airman from their shop, a photographer, who's now been reassigned, was selected for Airman of the Year for Air Force Special Operations Command Public Affairs. She competed at the Air Force level. She was selected as the Airman of the Year for the Air Force Public Affairs, and oh, by the way, she was selected as the best of the best, meaning she was what we believe to be the best person, public affairs, of any rank in the United States Air Force last year. And I know you were behind that a lot. I know you. I can see your delvings in there without even really talking about it, and that's a pretty amazing way to go out. As we all know, being active duty, military is not just the member, it's the family as well, and I know there were sacrifices on your part, but I hope there was actually some good times too, some adventures, two wonderful children, right? So, three wonderful children. Three, two, three. It varies on day to day, right?
I know.
Is it two or three today?
Three.
Three today, okay, got it. And there's sacrifices and adventures and probably ups and downs like everything else, but hopefully it went well for you as well. And I know we appreciate your service because it's a team effort. It's a team effort in the office and it's a team effort at home. Because when he deploys or goes to do the job, you're there to manage that piece. Your sacrifice is obviously noticed in most of the places. With that, I'll turn it over to the next step.
Ladies and gentlemen, please rise for the presentation of Sergeant Holcomb's retirement award. Thank you. Attention to orders. Senior Master Sergeant Holcomb, according to Special Order Number AC-005762, effective 3 November 2011, you are relieved from active duty, organization, and station of assignment, retired effective 30 November 2011, under the provisions of the Air Force Instruction 36-3203, in the grade of Senior Master Sergeant, with active service totaling 27 years, 3 months. Proceed to home selection by order of the Secretary of the Air Force. At this time, Sergeant Holcomb will receive his certificate of retirement from the Armed Forces of the United States of America, bearing these words: to all who shall see these presents, greeting. This is to certify that Senior Master Sergeant Kenneth Holcomb, having served faithfully and honorably, was retired from the United States Air Force on the third day of November 2011. Colonel James Slythe, Commander, 1st Special Operations Wing, and General Norton Schwartz, Chief of Staff of the Air Force. Sergeant Holcomb will now receive a certificate of appreciation from the President of the United States. Senior Master Sergeant Kenneth Holcomb, I extend to you my personal thanks and the sincere appreciation of a grateful nation for your contribution and of honorable service to our country. You have helped maintain the security of the nation during a critical time in its history with a devotion to duty and a spirit of sacrifice in keeping with the proud traditions of military service. Your commitment and dedication have been an inspiration for those who will follow in your footsteps, and for all Americans who join me today in saluting you for a job extremely well done. My best wishes to you for your happiness and success in the future. Barack Obama, Commander-in-Chief. Every retiree receives a special retirement pin as a memento of their active duty service. At this time, I'd like to ask Mrs. Jennifer Holcomb to place her husband's retirement pin on his lapel to symbolize his transition from active duty to retired status.
And no, we're good.
Use this. No flag ever devised by man has so clearly expressed the ideals of true democracy in its design. It has been literally the guiding star of our pioneers, explorers, humanitarians, and soldiers. It has interwoven its threads into the texture of every chapter of our national romance. No adult or child can comprehend the majesty of the history of the United States who is ignorant of the story of Old Glory. A thoughtful mind, when it sees a nation's flag, sees not the flag, but the nation itself. And whatever may be its symbols, its insignia, one reads chiefly in the flag, the government, the principles, the truth, the history that belongs to the nation that sets it forth. The American flag has been the symbol of liberty, and men and women rejoice in it.